This is one of the oldest mountain ranges on Earth. The high plateau of the Gran Sabana in the south of Venezuela. About 70 million years ago, erosion in the forests and steppes formed these mesas up to 1,000 meters high. 115 of these tepuis fill the landscape. Far away to one side, Tepuy Acopan dominates them all with its 700 meter vertical rock face. Unapproachable, unvanquished, unclimbed. It's the dream destination for this German-Venezuelan expedition.
The Acopan is a holy mountain. If you touch it, or go too close to it, or if you disturb it by making a noise, it will bring its wrath upon you.
Caracas. In the dawn light, the 4x4 leaves the capital before it becomes snarled up in the rush hour chaos of 100,000 cars. The expedition to Acopan Tepuy has already been put off several times. Finally, after 4 years of preparation, professional climber and adventurer Stefan Glovatz and his team are on the way to the mountain of their dreams. Glovatz had heard about this mysterious, unconquered Tepuy from a Venezuelan climber. Now, with him, Ivan Calderon, they want to be the first to climb it.
We're setting off on an adventure that has its own rules, its own laws, and we can't predict what will happen. Every day, every hour, we'll be faced with new challenges. Certainly, I see myself as an adventurer, and this is my way of life, expeditions like this one. First ascents. Of course, I don't see myself as a Christopher Columbus, maybe just a little.
Kurt Albert has traveled the globe. He's a living legend in the climbing world. He and Holger Heuber come from the same part of Germany, and they've been friends for years. Holger is the steady one of the team. He's a kayak expert and a top expedition planner.
We're dreaming of getting to the summit, but we're not there yet. Let's see what's in store for us up there.
There's a 1,200 kilometer journey ahead of them. Just getting to the mountain is a challenge. They've decided to make their way by land and water, not to fly. It's a more sporting approach, but more uncertain too, because the 4x4 can only take them to within 100 kilometers of the Acopan Tepuy. Ivan Calderon knows of a river, the Rio Caruay, that leads close to the mountain. But he doesn't know if it's fully navigable. Still another 500 kilometers to the domain of the Tepuys. Scientists call these mesas islands in time. Their jagged peaks are archives of evolution. For the local Pemón Indians, they're the homes of the gods. In 1962, part of the Gran Sabana was made a national park. Ever since then, the Venezuelan authorities have demanded huge sums from foreigners who want to stay in the park, sums that a non-commercial expedition could never afford to pay. If you haven't got official permission, you have to do a deal with the Pemón. In Cavanayen, the last village that can be reached by car, Ivan Calderon negotiates with the village chief behind closed doors. Thanks to Ivan's tactful negotiating skills, the chief gives them permission to drive on to the Rio Caruay. But the climbers have to make space for Roberto and Camillo. Their presence is the price of the pass. Camillo and Roberto will accompany the team as far as the Yonek settlement at the foot of the Acopan, as paid guides. This is what the chief decided. Whether they like it or not, the team has no choice but to accept these conditions that will limit their freedom of movement. Folding kayaks of aluminium and PVC will soon be their mode of transport on the Rio Caruay. Roberto and Camillo have their doubts about this high-tech equipment. As children, they learned to navigate the river in Curiara, their dugout canoes. After 2 days of monotonous, meditative paddling, they start to hear a roaring sound that gets louder and louder. Camillo steers his dugout safely to the riverbank. Rapidos peligrosos, he says, dangerous rapids. For Camillo, the answer's obvious. He empties his dugout so he can drag it along from the safety of the bank. Stefan Glowacz and kayak expert Holger Heuber are equally sure of their plan.
I think next time we'll have to unload. It's just too heavy. No way.
This won't be the last time that Camillo has a good laugh at their expense. Soon afterwards, Kurt Albert's kayak is damaged.
There was a branch sticking out against the current, and it cut through the kayak like a knife. Here it is, 30 centimeters. We'll have to fix it.
It has to be completely taken apart to be repaired. By chance, the team discover a Pemun family living in a clearing close by. They're completely cut off from the outside world, living under a flimsy straw roof. The nearest store is 5 days hard paddling away. Hospitality is not something that's talked about here. It's simply offered. With malnutrition, parasites, and the lack of any medical care, life is far from easy for these Pemon Indians, whose forefathers settled in the high plateau of the Gran Sabana 700 years ago. And yet this way of life must fascinate anyone who comes from a Western consumer society. A brief insight into a way of life we haven't known for centuries.
It smells so pungent. I think this is the drink they gave us yesterday.
Es la bebida de ayer.
They put the grated yucca into this tube, and as they stretch it, the liquid gets pressed out.
While the patches on the kayak are drying, Kurt Albert has a go in Roberto's dugout.
I can just about keep it steady. That's about as much as I can do today.
Good, Heiger. Good performance.
He's shown us he's the man again. If we'd have wanted to come in dugouts, we'd have had to practice for 2 weeks first, wouldn't we? I think we'd find it fascinating to live like this for a short while, but always knowing that we could return to our own environment. I mean, we just don't belong here. This is their way of life, their country. For us, it's like being able to play the wild man for a while, but then it has to be enough. I don't think I could be happy here in the long run, living in these conditions. But you still get to take the experience and a lot of impressions back with you.
Adios.
Adios.
Ciao.
Gracias.
Deeply moved, the team continue their journey. As they leave, they're told they're the first strangers ever to have passed by here. Rapids and waterfalls block their way much more frequently than expected.
It's like Fitzcarraldo. Da hinten geht's zu Fitzcarraldo hin.
Each time, everything has to be unloaded. First the empty boats and then 400 kilos of equipment have to be carried bag by bag past the unnavigable sections. At 30 degrees Celsius and 100% humidity, every diversion is torture. Deep in the jungle, they have to cut their way along barely discernible hunters' trails. Some of these diversions take up to half a day. It's been almost a week now since they first took to the Rio Caruay. And of the mountains, there's no sign at all. In my everyday life, I long for this kind of time out, this sense of calm. That's one of the reasons why I keep traveling to these places, not just for the climbing challenge, but to break free from the fast lane, to be able to follow your own thoughts and just be yourself, without any pressure, without any deadlines or obligations. To be able to travel in a landscape like this, under these conditions, with a boat, sometimes together with the local people, paddling beside you in a dugout. I mean, those are experiences you will never forget. That's what I call real riches. Every waterfall and every stretch of rapids delays them even further. And the Rio Caruay has more than enough to offer. Stefan Glovax and his team had expected the journey would be a lot easier and above all quicker. The unshakable calm of their guides, Roberto and Camilo, reminds them how pointless it is to make plans and schedules in this world. With every stroke of the paddle, they understand its rhythms a little bit better. Then, after 7 days and nights on the river, never knowing how close it would bring them to their goal or when they would arrive, they suddenly see that Cerro Acopan. After days of solitude, they meet people on the river again. A Pimon family shows them the way to the settlement of Yonek, on a fork of the Rio Caruay. By local standards, Yonek is the equivalent of a city. 20 huts, dotted round the deforested grasslands, have pushed back the jungle more and more. Nothing is grown here except manioc, the yucca plant, the staple food of the Pemon. There are a few parrots and some dogs, but the Pemon don't rear any animals. Hardly any tourists come here. Once or twice a year, a bush plane comes with a few usually rich foreigners. Village Chief Leonardo is impressed by the fact that these visitors have come by boat.
No sé cómo llegaron, pero...
I can't imagine how you got here. It seemed impossible to me that strangers could get here by boat.
No persona han llegado con el bote.
The river is very difficult. But now that you are here, you're very welcome.
Están bienvenidos, pues.
The Pimon's traditional costume has given way to jeans. And like anywhere else, the children play football. The missionaries came with the first bush planes in the 60s. They left behind not just their Baptist faith, but also a church. But these outside influences couldn't suppress their belief in the traditional myths and legends, nor their traditional way of life. As a child, Julio was sent to a mission station to learn to read and write. It was several days downstream in civilization. He experienced life with TV and Coca-Cola, and yet he still came back and started a family here in Yonek. He's proud of the stories that are told in the village. For Julio, as for everyone else here, these are not myths, but reality.
The misas are holy. You must not touch them or make a loud noise near them. If you do that, the heavens will darken and the rain will come.
A handful of expeditions have already tried to conquer the Acopan. Other teams have climbed the smaller walls of neighboring peaks, but so far the overhangs on the east face of the main mountain have resisted all attempts to defeat them.
Okay.
In spite of all the warnings, the climbers ask permission to take up the challenge of the Acopan. Camilo sets off to hunt in the forest. He and Roberto have done their duty. It's time to go. Without exchanging more than a few words, the team got to respect and appreciate their quiet guides. Only when they get back will they learn that Roberto never returned from the hunt, lost in the green labyrinth of the jungle. I think that creatures live there, spirits that sometimes appear. My grandfather told me that they once took someone with them back to that mountain over there. We call these spirits Mahiko. They don't appear as often now as they used to, when I was the first person to approach the mountains. But they're still there, everywhere. Of the jungle surrounding the mountain, one day's walk from Yonek, they find a good place beside a stream to establish their base camp. There's been only one storm shower since the team left Caracas, but now, just as they're building the shelters, the sky is beginning to darken. Leonardo, the village chief, has come with them to the foot of the sacred mountain. Not just to earn a little money as a guide, but because he's genuinely concerned for the climbers, but also for his forest, his land, and his mountain.
It's going to be pouring down any second.
The first tropical storm hits the half-built camp with full force. Soaked to the skin, Kurt and Ivan try to protect their equipment from the rain. They're amazed how fast the storm broke. Leonardo is amazed that they're amazed. It's taken the team 12 days to reach the vertical face, almost a week longer than they expected. And there's still one last obstacle on the way to the wall. They have to hack a trail through the thicket of ferns, trees, and lianas with their machetes.
There's a poisonous snake in this jungle. We call it Guanga Pingma. It's poisonous and dangerous. Is it deadly? Of course, it's deadly. And if you frighten it, it will chase you. But with all the noise we're making, there's no danger, is there? Well, if you annoy it, it jumps this high. Very dangerous. The day before yesterday, one of the young people in the village was bitten by the snake, so apparently there are some here. In any case, I think in the next few days, I'll tread a bit more carefully around here. I'll wear my hiking boots too, rather than wearing my sandals. There! There! Oh man, you just walked right past it! You almost walked right into it!
We really have to watch out now. Look, my hairs are standing on end, see? They don't seem to be very scared of us.
After 2 days, they've finally made it. It's been hard work, but Stefan, Holger, Kurt, and Ivan are finally standing at the base of the wall of their dreams. Scaling this face will not be a cakewalk. Big overhangs block the view of the upper sections of cliff. It's breathtakingly steep.
That is steep. We could even climb protected from the rain. Right then, let's go.
The team reckon they'll need at least 10 days to climb the 700-meter high wall. That's 70 meters a day. It sounds like nothing. But a rock wall as steep and compact as this makes you struggle for every centimeter.
Well done, Ivan. The first pitch. Yes, that's the first step done.
One or two pitches at the most. Each pitch is a 50-meter rope. Is all you can hope to climb in a day. At the end of the day, the rope is anchored at the highest point, so the climbers can abseil down and then climb up again. After one or two days on the wall, a two-man team will sign off and hand over the tiring and stressful work to the other team. The ceaseless rainfall makes life in the base camp unpleasant, and the wall almost unclimbable.
What's the plan of action? Well, the plan of action is to get up to the last point where we return, as soon as it stops raining. But I'd only go if it stops before 4 o'clock. Otherwise, it's going to be pointless.
That afternoon, Stefan and Holger take advantage of a brief break in the weather to take over at the highest point reached by their friends. Tests the climbers to the utmost, but it also protects them. Even in the strongest rain, they can still climb the overhanging northeast face without getting wet. But that also makes it more dangerous for them. Rain would normally help break off loose rock from the areas of the cliff weakened by erosion. But on the route they've chosen beneath the overhangs, they come upon stretches where the red sandstone literally crumbles beneath their fingers. Stefan and his team are not the first climbers to test themselves on this wall. A few years ago, an American expedition tried to find a way up Akopan's concave wall. Leonardo remembers how they came by plane. He tells the team of the anger of the mountain, of the climber who fell, and how he and his people had to carry the injured climber back to the landing strip and the waiting plane. Since then, the Akopan has remained untouched.
En ese castillo había un águila.
An eagle lived on this tepuy. Its name was Tiritiri. When people came too close, he grabbed them and ate them. But one day, he attacked our ancestor and dragged him to the summit of Acopan. He flew from one peak to the next because the old man fought so bravely. With all that flying, the eagle soon got tired. And the old man was clever. He had his axe with him. And he chopped off one of the eagle's wings.
Le dio por las alas, le partió.
But the old man's wounds were bad, and just as the dying eagle predicted, a few days later, he was dead.
Ivan Calderon gets ready to take over the lead with Kurt Albert. Stefan Glowatz and Holger Huber got more than halfway up, attaching four more ropes, before the crumbling wall forced them back down to base camp. By day seven, Kurt Albert has 400 meters of thin air under his climbing boots. In the 70s, he brought free climbing to Germany, and even now, he's trying to ascend without technical aids, relying only on tiny ledges and depressions in the rock. The rope is only there as life insurance. This compact vertical wall tests him to the limit.
Dami cuerda! Muy bien!
On a difficult climb like this, controlled falls happen a lot. For the Pemón, this is a sign of the mountain's anger. For the climbers, it's routine.
I think we climbers have a special relationship to the mountains. No, I don't think our presence is responsible for the rain. I respect the local people's beliefs, especially since they've been passed down for hundreds of years. But I still don't believe our presence or the fact that we're climbing here causes the rain.
Kurt and Ivan have managed to reach the last third of the rock face. Back at camp, they discuss with the others what to do next.
And now we're up on the ledge, and now there's another strip of 100 meters that looks pretty difficult. So we'll have to have another go, take food with us, 30 liters of water, onto the wall, and then we stay till we're up there. It could take 3 or 4 days. Teamwork. Two to do the climbing, and the others carry all the supplies. The tepui we've chosen to climb is actually difficult to climb from any direction. In fact, you can only get to the summit of this mountain via this route, this wall. No one has ever been up there. And of course, that's something really unique and inspiring.
Day 9, 150 meters to go. 2 days ago, both teams went up together, combining their efforts to achieve a breakthrough. This is their last chance, because they're running out of food. As the rear team drags up the equipment and supplies bag by bag, the front pair are pushing upwards into the unknown. They've taken water for 4 days. After that, they'll have to go back. too high now to abseil down to base camp in the evening. At the end of the day, exhausted from their efforts, each must find a tiny island with just enough space to sit or lie down. In between fitful moments of sleep, they count the minutes until daybreak. Signs, legends, and reality. This morning their thoughts are a mixture of anticipation and fear, curiosity and uncertainty. Holger Heuber wakes the rest of the team.
Vamos. Get up. Come on.
There is now a 600-meter drop beneath them and 100 meters of brittle rock above their heads. That's the situation on this last climbing day. If they don't get to the summit today, all their efforts will be wasted. Yet another overhang is in their way. The efforts of the last few days have left their mark. Kurt Albert feels and forces his way carefully upwards, trying not to waste energy, because he hasn't got much left. The vital thing now is not to lose his way in the maze of overhangs and crevices. There are few climbers in the world who've completed as many first ascents as Kurt Albert. Today, he needs all his experience to navigate in this vertical sea of rock. The Akopan is merciful. With each meter upwards, the rock becomes firmer and easier to climb. Stefan Glowatz takes the last rope. He has dreamed of this for 4 long years. He's trained just as hard as in his days of competitive climbing, when he won one international title after another. But here, 700 meters over the jungle, he's forgotten about the competitions. This is all about fulfilling a dream. Stefan anchors the rope, and that's it.
I'm on belay.
He's passed the last obstacle before reaching the top. The rest of the team can follow him on the fixed line. The spell is broken, and with a burst of fresh energy, they carry on up to the summit. There were times in the past weeks when they began to doubt they would ever get up here. But they've made it. With or without the permission of the Akopan.
We've done it. Great.
Stefan.
The climb yesterday was just fantastic. And to get to the top of this mesa, that was a high point, a memory to keep forever. To sit up here after 11 days hard work on the wall, it's almost an indescribable feeling. Wonderful. And now the weather's coming in, it looks as though we ought to go. Who says so? The gods.
The Aquapan won't like it if you try to climb it, Leonardo warned the climbers. And it does seem as though the Pemón sacred mountain only tolerated the strangers. Myth, faith, or just coincidence? But on the day the climbers leave, it stops raining.
Mistura os caçadores de mitos com um fenômeno cultural que está pegando fogo e adiciona duas equipes de engenheiros e artistas em uma competição acirrada, você tem
3, 2, 1
máquinas complexas, cheias de criatividade e sem qualquer finalidade. A nova série de Adam e Jamie, Reação em Cadeia, quartas, no Discovery 8D Theater.